Hey beer nerds, this is Ryan with Beer by the Numbers, and today we're talking about an aspect of beer and alcohol science that we beer fans don't often talk about. Drunk driving. Specifically, how do breathalyzers work when it comes to establishing if you're drunk or not? Before we get into the science of how alcohol is absorbed in the body and the clever ways we measure it, a friendly public service announcement. Don't drink and drive. Seriously, in the age of Uber and Lyft, where a car is literally a few taps away on your phone, there's no reason to risk your own safety and the safety of others by driving after you've had a beer too many. Okay, now that my warning is out of the way, let's get started. Now, as far back as the late 1920s, scientists were studying the levels of alcohol on the breath of drinkers. These experiments often involved drinkers blowing into balloons or other air bladders so that the liquids in their breath could be extracted and chemically tested. In 1931, the first practical roadside breath testing device was the drunkometer, developed by Rolla Neer Harger of the Indiana University School of Medicine. The drunkometer collected a motorist's breath sample directly into a balloon inside the machine. The breath sample was then pumped through an acidified solution. If there was alcohol in the breath sample, the solution changed color. The greater the color change, the more alcohol was present in the breath. However, judging color changes isn't the most accurate form of measurement. So in 1954, Robert Frank Borkenstein created a breathalyzer that used chemical oxidation and photometry to determine alcohol concentration. Now, all that science talk sounds pretty complicated. It's actually a little simpler than the terms would lead you to believe. When the user exhales into a breath analyzer, any alcohol present in the breath is oxidized into acetic acid at the anode of a small contained battery. This reaction creates a small electrical current which is measured by a microcontroller and then displayed as an approximate blood alcohol concentration. The more ethanol in the breath, the more electric current is generated. So how in the world does alcohol get into one's breath anyway? Ethanol, the alcohol we consume in alcoholic beverages, is a relatively small molecule. As such, it's pretty easily absorbed through the stomach and into the blood. Alcohol is pretty volatile too, and your body is warm. So each time you breathe, a small amount of the alcohol in your blood vaporizes and is passed into the alveoli in your lungs and then passed out of your body. The more alcohol you have consumed, the greater the amount passes out. Some natural and volatile interfering compounds do exist, however. For example, the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration has found that dieters and diabetics may have acetone levels hundreds or even thousands of times higher than those in others. Acetone is one of the many substances that can be falsely identified as ethyl alcohol by some breath machines. Substances in the environment can also lead to false BAC readings. For example, methyl tert-butyl ether, a common gasoline additive, has been alleged antecedently to cause false positives in persons exposed to it. Tests have shown this to be true for older machines, however, newer machines detect this interference and compensate for it. Any number of other products found in the environment or workplace can also cause erroneous BAC results. These include compounds found in lacquer, paint remover, celluloid, gasoline, cleaning fluids, alcohols, and other volatile compounds. One of the most common causes of falsely high breath analyzer readings is the existence of mouth alcohol. In analyzing a subject's breath sample, the breath analyzer's internal computer is making an assumption that the alcohol in the breath sample came from deep within the lungs. However, alcohol may have come from the mouth, throat, or stomach for a number of reasons. To help guard against mouth alcohol contamination, certified breath test operators are trained to observe a test subject carefully for at least 15 to 20 minutes before administering the test. There are also rumors of a number of substances or techniques that can fool a breath analyzer. A great 2003 episode of MythBusters tested a number of methods that supposedly allow a person to fool the breath test. The methods they tested included breath mints, onions, denture cream, mouthwash, pennies, and batteries. And all of these methods proved ineffective. The show also noted that using these items to cover the smell of alcohol may fool a person, but since they were not actually reducing a person's BAC, there's really no effect on the breath analyzer test. The Mythbusters episode also pointed out another complication with these methods. It would be necessary to insert them into one's mouth, take the breath test, and then possibly remove the item, all of which would have to be accomplished discreetly enough to avoid alerting the police officers administering the test. So no matter how hard one may try, it's really hard to avoid the scientific realities behind the breathalyzer and how it measures alcohol in your body. So remember, don't drink and drive, and enjoy your next beer responsibly.